over the last 20, 25 years, we have been living through a revolution in the field of astronomy. We realized about in the early 1990s that the solar system does not end with Neptune or Pluto, right? The kind of last objects that we thought were the end for a long time. Instead, we have discovered that there's a belt of icy debris out there called the Kuiper Belt. This field of icy debris is remarkable. Okay? If you look at the solar system from the side, from the plane of the solar system in which we live, the Kuiper Belt really forms something that resembles a donut of orange orbits. So we will see that in a second. So these are all of the big asteroid-like pieces of debris that we know are there today, and an orange with orange circles, what is shown are the orbits of these objects. So it looks like this big torus of stuff. So one of the remarkable features of the Kuiper Belt, and you can see this just by looking at the slide, is that all of the orbits of these pieces of icy asteroids physically hug the orbit of Neptune. Right, you see that here, where all the big orange circles come and touch the largest pink circle, which is the orbit of Neptune. There's a physical reason for why this must be the case. All of these icy asteroids were emplaced into their current orbits by Neptune scattering them and kicking them out. Okay, and gravity is a conservative force, which means that you have to always come back to where you started. So all of these asteroid orbits change over time, but that feature of being attached to Neptune stays the same, because that's how the Kuiper Belt was formed. For a long time, this was thought to be well understood and kind of the full story, until about a decade ago, my friend Mike Brown discovered an object called Sedna, whose orbit looks like this. It's completely unlike any other object in the Kuiper Belt. So you can just, by looking at the just extreme nature of that orbit, realize that something else is going on. The sheer size of it, the sheer ellipticity of it, suggests that there's more to be learned about the solar system than just a belt of icy stuff beyond Neptune. What we noticed a couple years ago is that actually, the story is even more interesting. If you look at the most distant orbits, the objects which live on the furthest orbits that we know of today, then they all kind of point in the same direction, right? I don't know if you can see this beautifully on the slide, but you can almost put a piece of paper through the plane of all those objects, and they all point in the same overall direction. And that's remarkable. So the fact that all of these orbits are aligned together and clustered in the same way suggests that there's something else in the solar system pushing them, confining them together into the same direction. I would like to spend the next 45 minutes to explain this slide, that you can start to understand why that is by doing a little bit of math. And what the mathematics suggests immediately is that the outer solar system, the structure of this outer solar system, points to the existence of an additional planet which lives far, far beyond Neptune. Thankfully, today we have remarkable computational resources available to us, and you don't have to just do math on the board or on a piece of paper. You can go to supercomputers, which is what I did at Caltech, where I work. My office is directly above a floor which is entirely filled with a giant machine, which is shown here on the slide. So using this supercomputer, we've decided to do the following experiment. We decided to explore how the solar system formed and evolved. So by solving the proper equations on this supercomputer, we were able to simulate the entire lifetime of the solar system, the 4.5 billion years dramatic evolution of our cosmic home. And one of the things that we noticed immediately, as shown in this little simulation video, and this is a result of the calculation, is that if we introduce a new planet into the solar system whose orbit is shown as that big purple ellipse, then what we notice is that long period orbit begins to confine, okay, and begins to cluster the orbits of the Kuiper belt, the icy debris, the blue orbits that you see, and they all point the opposite way. Right, you get to see that just about now, where the long blue orbits that are kind of dancing around the slide are all starting to point in the opposite direction from the pink orbit that represents the planet. So using this computer model and the data that we have available, we have been able to not observe but calculate a pretty precise orbit and mass for the existent planet which is out there, and we see its evidence entirely through the gravitational pull that it exerts on the distant solar system. One of the remarkable kind of final things to add to the story is that we noticed that in addition to the existence of this belt of aligned orbits, the gravitational pull of the planet produces another population of objects which are strongly tilted with respect to the plane of the solar system. This is something that our mathematics just predicted. And when we went out and looked for them, turns out they are actually out there, the solar system. So we are currently conducting an observational search for this elusive planet. We're using one of the biggest telescopes on Earth, called the Subaru telescope, which is shown as the kind of blocky telescope on the left-hand side of the slide. And inside of it, it is amazing. It is an amazing engineering project, right? It is a telescope far bigger than this building, and it is just an amazing piece of robotics. So my sincere hope is that we will detect this object. Maybe we will find it in this year, this fall. Maybe it will take 5 years, but I think that on a timescale of a decade or two, the count of planets in our solar system will once again become 9.